Sounds good.
Okay, so you can add yourself even later. However, I will start our presentation also and with Martin Thomas, which is my name, and to be sure you are recognizing also I put the information on the first slide. So who will the little Ole and who is the little Martin? I know this is pretty old picture, so there is, let's say, not so big difference like now when we have lockdown in our country and every barber shop is closed, and now I look like more like Monte Cristo. So let me introduce first, or no, first I'm very interested why you are here. Okay, so you can choose on your mobile phone one of these answers. If you like Kova, press red one. If you like OLS, press a blue one. If you like me, press yellow one. If you like webinars at all, press the green one. You got 10 more minutes, seconds, sorry. And I see it's going very well. So how the first poll will look like. Now I will see if I have more friends or Kova has more friends. Nobody loves me. Okay, so we got like OLS lovers and Kova lovers, which is very good, and some webinars lovers. So now we'll check how it works. So I will introduce myself. My name is Martin Thomas. In our country, Martin and Thomas are first names, so it's a little bit crazy, but usually outside of our country, it's easy. And I will begin with this not so outdoor photograph because now I can't guide anyone, and my activity in forests are limited with all the regulation we got because of the coronavirus situation in Czech Republic, which is pretty bad. So I have to went back to my previous job, which is the technology consultancy. So now you can see how I can look if I have a proper care of my barber, and also I wear a suit and so on. And yes, this is what, let's say, make me survive, especially economical way. However, if you will Google my name, you will definitely find more information about my activity with predators. As the Jeff already mentioned, I'm very active, especially concerning mammals or felids. Let's say it's like 5 or 6 years ago already, I ran a very nice, but it wasn't webinar, but seminar about lynx in Czech Republic, but not only in Czech Republic, but also in countries around like Slovakia, Austria, and Germany. And it was 11 people participated in the seminar. It was very successful, and I'm very glad I did it because it helped to understand people that the predators are very important in ecosystems and in nature. So if you will Google it, then you will find definitely some photos with lynx. This lynx is not wild, for your information. It was the orphan lynx from one zoo. And because it was orphaned from very beginning, it was third day, we had to keep it out from the mother and feed it. And the bond of the lynx was established with us, with me and my friend. So it will be very, it was very contactful animal, and a lot of children and people enjoyed it. And I think it was one of the biggest ambassadors for wildlife in Europe till now. The next picture is representing me pretty well because it represents my most favorite place in the world, I think, which is in Himalaya. You can see me by the bridge on Indus River in Ladakh, which is northwest of India. And I like climbing mountains, and also I very love snow leopards. And I did few expeditions. And I hope I will do more with my clients and with myself to spot them, and they make movies. By the end of this webinar, you will have a chance to know where you can find more information, more photos or more videos from my activities. And you will definitely find even the movie about snow leopards I did with mobile phone and the Kova spotting scope 883. So it was with very, very easy setup. And Yeah, this is more likely you will meet me if you will meet me in the nature, if you will find me, okay? So let's say hide covered with such a camouflage things. And oh, I found one mistake on my picture. This is the older picture, yes. Now, oops, I got the, I will put it back, sorry. Now I got the Cova Genesis Promenade 10 by 22 because I become the Cova ambassador 1 month ago. So I switched from my old binocular to this beautiful one, really beautiful one. I love it. I was using, let's say, top level, small binocular. However, the Genesis is perfect. I really love Cova. So we got same passion, I think. So, oh, we got the new poll. What topic you are interested in concerning all? You are interested in all facts, how to search for owls, useful technology for owl spotting or night owl photography. So let me check and I will focus more on topics you expect more. Last 5 minutes to vote. Okay, so 24 of you, so this is majority is how to search for owls, and we got some technology and night owl photography, an interesting owl fact. Finally, this question, yeah, I learned this question from politicians because they are usually asking, however, they will continue their own way, and I will do the same stuff. However, I will continue to through all the topics, so don't worry, you will miss one. And I hope you will enjoy it because it will be pretty fast with a lot of pictures and a lot of quizzes. First, I have to explain you how I became an owl lover, and I was thinking about it when I was preparing my presentation pretty much, where or when it was the first time I really fell in love with this beautiful animal species. And I did it. I found it. Maybe you did it the same way because it was because of one movie, and I will present it for you. So you recognize the Clash of Titans movie, the original one, because there's a new one. And because I was pretty young at the time, I was not interested in beautiful princesses, let's say not even a beautiful prince. And Medusa was ugly and the Kraken was a bad one. So I pick up the very clever and very, very brave owl to love. And yes, this love is still valid. So first quiz question for you. To have a points, how many owl species do you think we got worldwide? So we will start with the interesting facts about owls. So you can win first points for our quiz competition. Come on, if you don't want, just guess. It's very easy. Last 3 seconds, and how many points we will get? Yes, 14 correct answers because we got the 250, approximately 250 owl species. And who is the first, let's say, now Juanan or Juanan, Matias and SG on the third place, but it's very close to, so you have to focus on next quiz questions. We got this 250 old species in one order, and you know it, it's strigiforms in Latin and or in scientific. And we got two families, Titanidae and Strigidae, which are, let's say, true owls or barn owls concerning Titanidae. And all the old species are inside of these families. However, 250 is, let's say, not a big number, because the owls are usually uphill or on top of trophic cascade. Maybe you know this basic ecological know-how. However, they are predators, so they are on top of it. And usually the animals on top of this, there are very few in number and very few in species. However, we got many or few, I will say few is a better word, few all species which are all many continents. I can say the long-eared owl you can see on my background. However, owls are living, or owls live in almost all continents besides Antarctica. So you can find it everywhere. What is very interesting fact about owl is this BBB fact, which is one of the best bird brains. And yes, why owls have such a big brain with a lot of structures inside? Because they use very, very, very sensitive, very well built it up senses. And two of the most, I think, important senses for owls are hearing and vision. And I will tell you something about it. The owls have a, let's say, hearing from 21,000 hertz or 21 kilohertz, which is not such a special if you compare it, for example, with humans and so. However, in the bird environment, or even if you compare it with the prey, so in mice and all rodents environment, it is very, very good hearing in an animal, between the animals in such a trophic cascade. And they can really hear the mice even if it is hidden underneath some snow. So maybe you got the experience, especially if you live in the northern countries of Europe or America or in Asia, you find something special, like a special sign on snow, which looks like after the angel landing. So you see some sign of wings, and usually there is a small hole in between. So this is usually the spot where the owl attacked some mice covered by snow. However, the owl hear it, even it's so small, even it's so, let's say, quiet comparing with other animals, but owls can hear it. However, if you are, let's say, naive concerning owls, they don't use these feathers they got on their head, okay? So these feathers are not any part of hearing, and I will show you where the hearing is. Here is the skull of boreal owl, and you can see the big holes like on the right and left side, and this is the hearing system, and you can see it's pretty asymmetrical, and the asymmetrical ear placement helps owl to perfectly focus the place where the sound comes from. And also, they use the special technique for focusing, and you know it very well. I put here a few images, and when the owls are rotating with their heads, they are using it because of even most specific or more specific focusing of sound source. So when you will see the owl, and the owl will, let's say, move the head, and it start to be very, very funny. It's not because of owls like to act like actors or play some games with you. However, they are focusing from where the sounds come from. And on the small picture down on my slide, you see Borello as well, and with a small red circle around. But if you will check all the O's, you know, or almost all the O's, you will see there is something like a circle shape of their head, and it's because of feathers. And these feathers has the same functionality like a satellite, parabolas, and they help to get more, let's say, sound from mices and all the prey, all the predators as well, and helping them to get them to this asymmetrical ear placement and have a better information about the position. So this is about hearing of owls. And also, I mentioned owls are very, very good in vision. They got the excellent vision. For comparison with our vision, they got in retina 1 million rod cells. Rod cells, I'm not talking about cones, but rod cells per square millimeter. Let's say average human has 200,000 only. So it's five times better vision in comparison with human. To try to imagine how far it is, try to imagine it's let's say like a night, but usual night, which is not a 100% dark, and the owl can see small mouse. Like if we will see it with our vision, it will be more than a few hundred meters from us. So try to imagine you can see small mouse 200 meters, for example, from you. And if you will see it, you will have a same vision like the owls are. What is very important, and especially for the owl searching and owl spotting, is that they got the very limited or even non-cone cells. So these cells in the retina are responsible for color vision or colored vision, and they don't have it, or they have only very, very, very few. So the scientists think that mostly or most species of owls vision is only monochromatic or monochrome, and they can't see colors. However, I think there is not let's say big problem for owls. And this is big advantage for searching for owls, but I will go through a little bit later, so you will see. So next quiz question, so get a pick some points. I will ask you, what do you think, what angle owls can use with their vision? So 340, 270, 120, or 70 degrees. And that is a little bit of informatic trap. So if you are ornithologists, you will maybe fall in. So come on, last 5 minutes. So 16 correct answer, it's 270. But I have to say this 270 degrees is a, let's say, angle of view using head movement. Because if we will count only the angle of view without head movement, we will count around 70 as a binocular view. However, 270 is, let's say, usually used by all the owls. And, you know, owls can pretty much turn the head around. So 270 is perfect. Otherwise, they got owls which are directed only one straight way. So it's very important for them. So who is on the first place now? Matthias is going up, SG and Mike's. Okay, so let's go further. What is very interesting for owls, and finally you can recognize even the feathers from owls. Owls have a special technology for stealth flying. You know it from the aircraft industry. However, they got it from nature, and I will show you how it works. This serrated edges of flight feathers you can find on the wings reduces the aerodynamic noise. So usually if you are in the forest in the night and you are trying to search for owls, or you are even during the morning or evening and you are searching for owls which appears even during the day or with some light, you will not hear it usually. If you compare it with any other bird, you are usually hearing. slapping or movement of the wings, but because of the serrated edges, you cannot hear it. You cannot hear owls. So, you have to be very good with other sounds and also with other knowledge to find owls in your territory. However, this is perfect for masking before they attack their prey. So they are usually very successful concerning hunting. So next quiz question: in what altitude you can find owls? Up to 100 meter above sea level, or 3,300 feet, to 2,500, 8,200 feet, or up to 4,000 meters above sea level, or even above. So what do you think? So how brave they are. Yes, 12 correct answers. I will check who is now on top. SG is going very well. Congratulations. I will show you something, and this is my own spotting. I already told you that I really love to be in Himalaya, and this is a picture from Tukye Monastery in Tsokar Lake area, which is very close to Tibet or Tibetan Plateau, but on the Indian side. It's a very, very cold place, and this place is in 4,612 meters. And this very old monastery contains also a nesting pair of little owl, you know, from Europe. And finally, what is very interesting, that the little owls should, let's say, get to this place somehow. And if you know the place, around there are like mountains which are usually bigger than 5,000 meters. So the little owls should go over the hills with 5,000 meters above sea level altitude. So you can find owl species pretty, pretty high in the mountains. And there's not only the little owl, I got the experience with eagle, Eurasian eagle owl, also very high up in Himalaya. It was around the Rumbak village, very close to Leh in Ladakh. And it was also like 4,200 meters above sea level. So you can find them almost everywhere on the planet, even very high up. So what is very interesting. And the last interesting fact, because you can find even more, yeah, if you will check some old pages or some Wikipedia, or you will buy some books. But what is very interesting, and it was interesting because we did in Czech Republic some research about it, that in old ancient mythology, the owls was called like harbingers of death. Because people in that time thought that if someone is, let's say, fighting some illness, some serious illness, usually owls appeared around. And this is how the harbinger of death story was made up. And my quiz question, what is the scientific explanation? Why? The first choice is because owls often live at cemeteries. The second, owls hunt insects. The third, owls wait for mice eating the dead body. And the green one is owls are attracted by sound of crying. So what do you think, what we found? And what the scientists also on other places found, like the answer why the ancient myths, and even people in villages till now are thinking they are harbingers of death. So they are, let's say, following people who are dying. So you got the 41 answer, 42. Let's go. Okay. I did more time because there was a longer answer, so I will wait till 10 more seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and you will see who is correct. Oh, only 7 of you. The answer is because all hunt insects, and I will explain it for you. It's because the people really believed that if they will, let's say, make a dark in the room with such a sick or ill person, which is fighting against that, the death will easily come to such a person and take it, or take him. And so they keep a very, very big light in the room. And because all the insects are attracted by light, and because owls and many owl species are hunting insects as a prey, not only mice are hunted, so it attracted owls as well. And because it was very, very good place for owl hunting, usually the dominant male owls were hooting pretty much around. So the people really recognized that there are owls around because, and they thought that it was because they are, let's say, like following the death coming for such an ill person. So this is the scientific answer. And finally, we checked also if the places where the owls are, especially little owl in Central Europe, which is very close or very connected to this harbinger of that story, if the in villages and towns where the little owl is now, if there is a, let's say, bigger number of deaths per year. And we used one student of sociology, and we found that the numbers are same. So don't worry, if you will have all around, it will definitely not let's say, attract the death coming for you or for your friends. So how the chart looks like, it's very tight, but Huanan, JC and SG are now on top, so they will be rewarded if they will keep the position. So let's go on. We have to focus now for the owl searching, which is one of the hardest discipline. That's why I'm using the joke, the objects with low number of sightings. And maybe you cannot find even the owl on the picture, but it's behind the camera. And it's because during the day, the owls are really hardly visible. And why? There is a very special relationship, and I can say it's not the balance, but globally it's a balance between owls and songbirds. And because songbirds are usual prey for owls during the night, during the day, songbirds are attacking owls and trying to kick them out from the territory. This activity is called mobbing in ornithology, in the science, and it's pretty regular. If you tried any time to attract owls by your hooting or whistling and or using some speaker, if there is a place where the owls are active, you usually receive the response of the songbird first. They are very angry. They are trying to kick you out, even there is no real owl around. However, I will start with, let's say, searching mistakes. However, we will talk about what to do, how to find owls in environment around you. This funny picture with a little owl on a railway station, but finally, for little owl in Europe, it's nothing special because it is maybe 100 years ago, they nested in old trees. But now, almost in all countries, in all places, all areas where the little owl is connected, strictly connected to human buildings, houses, and so on. So we can call it, this is the typical synanthropic owl species. So if you will try to find them somewhere in the forest or in the bushes around the village or town, you will probably not be successful. But if you will go where some ruins are or where the old houses are with some holes where they can nest, where they can hide, and even in, as you see in, on a railway station, you will be more successful. And it's not only a little owl, who is very common in close environment with the people. This is one of the nicest owl from my opinion. This is a barn owl, or European barn owl. And this is also typical representant of synanthropic owl species. Maybe you know it because I think this is the nicest owl, but with most scary call in all area or all family. It's crazy. I can't even do it for you. But you know it if you were searching for barn owls. What is interesting for barn owls, from my point of view, is that they are almost everywhere, very active during the night. And I'm really surprised with the habits of owls in United Kingdom, because there are many, many sightings of barn owl during the day. And there's another country with the barn owl sightings during the day, which is Brazil in South America. However, in other part of the world, it's usually more nocturnal owl species. But they are not only in the villages. Finally, if you will search for the wood owls or for forest owls, you will be successful in forest, not in the village or in the town. However, because of, especially in Europe and maybe in America and even in Asia, because we are getting more and more and more and more environment of owls, and we are, let's say, shrinking their usual areas, I think the same future, like for little owls, will happen for many other species. For example, this Ural owl, which is very common, very deep in the forests, and if you find some meadow, like in Scandinavia, there's a big chance to find it, especially now when the spring is coming. Now in Central Europe, where is the bigger density of population, even Ural owl, very typical for deep forest, are coming to parks, and we got like many sightings now, even in parks in small towns, but usually they are connected to some mountains or to some forest, bigger forest area. However, you have to search for them in the forest. What is the very good, let's say, environment checking and searching method is to find old nests or old nesting holes from woodpeckers or woodpecker species. And if you find out what woodpecker species nesting holes fits to some old species, you got a big chance, if you will scratch on the tree from a down, that you can get the view from the owl. So don't overuse it, yeah, because you can let's say scare the owl if you will do it like 2 hours with no stopping. However, if you will do it once or two times or three times, and if you will repeat it like every 3 days, nothing's matter because the owls are pretty used to some predators and so on, and they will check always what's let's say source of this sound. Because they have to check if there is not a marten, pine marten, or other predators trying to get eggs or a small pools. So this is the perfect method. Up, there was a problem with sharing. Sorry, perfect method to search for owls. Here you can see boreal owl in the typical nesting hole of black woodpecker in Europe. And here you got the view you got from down from the tree. My friends are calling it that it looks like a pilot of Formula One, especially with the big eyes of the boreal owl. But this is very typical. But you can find even more species, not only this one. What is very important that you have to know how the owl species, concrete owl species or specific owl species behavior is, because there are some owls which are typical, and you can find them if you will check only the tops of trees, like for example this Scandinavian or North American northern hawk owl. I think if you will check, let's say, different direction, your success will be mostly like 5%, 10%, not more. But if you will go through like such these open open environments in between forest, you are, let's say, very with big potential. You will see northern hawk owl. But it's not only northern hawk owl. There are many other species all over the world. I will show you another typical for Europe, which is the Eurasian pygmy owl, which is also very typical to perch on top of spruces, and you can find it very easily. And because it's very small owl, it's like, I don't know, like a 4-inch big. It's very, very hard to find or search for it, let's say, in the middle of forest, or if you will try to find it in bushes. It's almost impossible. However, if you are equipped with special technology, it is possible, but I will talk about it later. I will tell you, for many other owls, the tactic to, let's say, look on top of trees is not successful, especially for the many synanthropic owl species, but not only for them, because as you can see on these pictures, these are owls from one spot, one place nearby the Prague. And if you try to check this tree from even 3-4 meters, you will not see any owl. However, if you will check underneath the tree, you can find drawings, which are typical for owls, because they are eating mice, and then they are throw some hair, some bones, and so on. And it looks like a, let's say, small piece of excrement or shit. However, it's not. And because of it, and because of presence of many of these, you can find place with many owls. I got 2 long-eared owls on a picture, but we found inside of these small trees 14 animals roosting and waiting before night will start. So for some owl species, you have to more look down the underneath the tree than on the tree or up on top of the tree. So if you got some let's say ornithologist or owl specialist, or if you have a time to read some books, always keep in mind that the owls have some behavior, and if you will follow the behavior, you will not do mistakes checking it. And I know, especially with this long-eared owl, it's very often, because there are many of them from north, from Scandinavia and Siberia, and it will be the same story in America, are going more southerly because of winter. And then they are roosting in huge quantities, like 50, 150, even more. Maybe you heard about Kikinda, which is a Serbian town, where they count, I think, more than 700 owls in few trees roosting in the central place of this small town. So they are coming down during the winter, and there is a big chance you can see them, you can show them to your children, and you can enjoy it and make pictures, and it's very easy. However, you have to find it. And because owls are very traditional, they are not changing destination, they are not changing environment, they are coming back many decades without any change. The change is usually caused by cutting a tree down, or if most owls from the group died, and so on. And now here you can see the Eurasian eagle owl, which is our biggest owl in Europe. Here, during the night, you can find it easily and very often on top of the tree, and this is very, very typical for eagle owl. However, even it's such a big owl, it's so scared because of the songbirds mobbing, that during the night, if you want to find some eagle owls, you have to check, as close as spruces and other big trees, and usually they are very hidden inside of the tree. And this picture was really accidental, because it was very, very huge wind, which was moving with the spruces, and there was a, let's say, one window, and I got like one second chance to make the photograph of this nice eagle owl female. And as you know, this is very big owl, but it's impossible to see it during the day, how camouflaged they are inside of the trees before the night came. Okay, another quiz question for you. What owl species is calling like that? So now you have to hear. If you can hear it. I hope so. Only two correct answers. This was the young one, long-eared owl, so Asiotus. Very typical sound if you live in towns, because they also they are nesting in towns very often because of a lot of food. They are typical representative of synanthropic owl species. During June or end of May or beginning of July, you can enjoy such a crazy sounds, and especially if there are like five small ones, five juveniles, with such a sound, you cannot sleep with open window for sure. So this was a long-eared owl, Asiotus juvenile. So who is the first one now? We got Matthias back in the first three. So let's go further. One more hint concerning owl searching. It is really hard to go to forest or even to walk inside of the village or town if you cannot recognize owl calls. There are many. So my recommendation is to, let's say, find or take one, two species which can live in your place. If you got some idea, they can be there. And here on the picture, you see the very, very, very famous website for people interested in bird sounds. So you can go to xenocanto.org, and then you put English or scientific name of the owl you are searching, and you can check all the sounds recorded by other ornithologists around the world, and you can even check different sound for different part of the year. So this is very important, because many owls are calling differently during spring and during summer, and then during autumn or during winter. So it's very hard for beginners or not so experienced owl spotters to understand it or remember it. So always before any trip you will do for owl searching, check this website. It's very useful. I think it's one of the most useful things if you want to search and spot some owls. And finally, if you will recognize the owl call and you will know what owl it is, then after reading or after some experience with the behavior of the owl species, you can easily find it again, because I already told you the owls are very, very conservative. They are conservative with the behavior, with the traditional behavior they got in the environment. So they are not changing it. So it's only weather what can destroy the owl spotting trip then, but not the knowledge. So enjoy the Xenocanto for sure. And if you will be good, you can even use the owl sound. And this was a video how we enjoyed all sound like for dance from the very, very famous Swedish techno DJ. It was, I think, nearby Uppsala. What is my magic? This is what you were interesting also, and people, my friends and known people from the phone scoping group on Facebook are asking in messages how I search for them. how it's possible I got so many pictures and so many spottings, and why I can promise so many owls to my clients, which are going with me as a guide. So I will reveal it. I don't worry. I think nature is not mine. You have to enjoy it. And finally, if you will enjoy it and if you will show it to your friends, I believe that people, if they know what interesting, what mysterious, what magical they got around their houses, they are then more caring and they are more sensitive to the nature, and they start to think a different way, not so devastating. So I will reveal it. There will be not a, let's say, surprises. There will be some surprises for sure. I think the most common friend or helper for my owl spotting is such a small thing, which is this speaker. However, you can use whatever speaker you want, but I love this JBL sound, which is pretty small. It's like a, I don't know, 10 centimeters maybe. So it's like a 4 inches size. You can very easily put it on branch or everywhere. And if you know how to attract owl using voices, it can be very, very useful. However, there are like a few ideas around. First idea is from ornithologists that they are saying, hey, you can harm the owl. If you will call the owl too much, you can harm it because it will lose the energy and it can find and maybe lose a partner and so on and so on. I can tell you something. After more than 30 years of experience, there was never such a sighting that the owl reacted like this. And if I compare it, what we do in Western countries like in Europe or America with the Asian ornithologists or Asian guide, it's completely different world. It's crazy how they're using these sounds. And finally, what I discovered, if something is overusing it, it usually leads that owl, because they got the big brain, is really recognized there is something like, not like a trap, but it's something what is artificial. So the owl usually stops reaction, and you will use a chance to spot it or photograph it. So this is, let's say, more important thing to say, that you can lose the owl contact if you will overplay some sound. So if you want to attract owls with calls, and it's very, very easy, or not easy, but it's very, very useful way, if you know what sound, finally, use it for a short time, and then try to spot or try to observe owl without it. Because what you can see then, usually, especially now in the spring, the male is coming usually first to check. And because the male is usually continuing with, let's say, hooting back to the artificial intruder, usually the female is coming. If the female is not in the nesting hole, or it's flying around, it's coming. So then you can see even both of them, and especially in the very beginning of mating period, you can see even the mating and all the behavior around, which is brilliant. And you can learn much more from the nature. I cannot say what speaker is the best. I think if it is, let's say, if it is amplifying some basses, it's good, because some also are more, let's say, bass tuned. However, I think if you use the JBL is very, very common in between ornithologists and scientists, using the call provocation as a technique for searching or counting owls. So if you don't use it, you can try. However, learn. This is a very important thing, because I already told you the owls have many different kind of sounds. And if you will, let's say, discover how to use it, you will be very successful. If you will not, it will be, let's say, very strange for the owl, and owl cannot or would not react for your provocation. And my quiz is, how many cone cells have owls in a retina in 1 square millimeter? Okay, 2 million, 1 million, 200,000, or very few. We got last 15 seconds. This is a very tricky question, and I will see how the results will look like last 3 seconds. And we got it. Yeah. This is great. You are listening. Yeah. The trap was that we were talking about rods. However, the cones are responsible for the color views or color vision, and they got almost none, so very, very few. And this is one, let's say, initial idea for my second tactic I'm using very, and I discovered it as a very, very useful. And yeah, how it does look like, JC and SG is going back. Matthias is kicked out from the first three places. However, here I reveal what I'm using. This torch, this flashlight. I don't know in what countries they are available. I think maybe worldwide because the Fenix is pretty known brand. But I think this is for now the only one flashlight or torch which contains a very powerful red light. And the red light is the key question because the red light will help you to find the hole very easily with not disturbing the hole with the light. If you will use the usual, the yellow one or white one, you know it from around or from your spottings till now. The hole will immediately fly away because it's a very disturbing retina and eye system. However, with red light, you can even have more power of the red light, and the hole, it's not visible for all. So it's very, very, very easy, spottable with the red light. And finally, if you want to make night pictures, and I will talk a little bit more about it, but if you are, let's say, a photographer which is using usual equipment, so the camera and usual lens, you can focus using the red light very easily. And usually, owls during the night, they don't know they are visible for us because they know that all the animals, like monkeys and humans and so on, cannot see very easily during the night or in the dark. So they can go very close. And if I am saying very close, it means it can be even 1.5 meter or 2 meters, even for very shy owls like the tawny owls are and many other species. So they can sit very, very close, and you can easily make a picture with short lenses, with very nice focusing, with the red light. And then, especially with this flash torch, you only rotate it with the head, and there get the two systems. But you have to prepare it before. And if you have prepared, let's say, very, very low light, which is with only few lumens, you can put some light on the hole. And if you know how to set up your camera with, let's say, some longer exposure, usually all is not moving during the night so much, so you can have perfect brilliant pictures without disturbing holes and prepared with exact focusing on the hole. So I will show you how it looks like in the used. This is the picture, how great it is. And especially I saw in the participants few clients which went outdoor for hours with me, and they know it. Many times it's you will have like a Harry Potter feeling because the owls will fly above your heads like 1 meter, 1.5 meters, so very, very close, and you will enjoy it because they don't know they are visible for you, so they are not scared, they are not disturbed, they don't worry. So this is one of the best, I think, discovery I did in last 10 years concerning animal spotting at all, because finally it's not only owls, it's most animal species which are used to be active during the night or in the beginning of night or end of the night. They don't react for red light. You can finally check it. You can finally check it on your cat or on your dog if you own some, or you can even check it your own way, especially during the night. If you will use the usual flashlight with the white or yellow light, and you will use, let's say, more powerful torch, and then you stop it, you are like blind for a few seconds before all the rods are getting back to functionality in retina. However, if you will check it and you will use the red light, even with any power, and you will stop the red light, you are not losing the night vision, let's say, as you got it before. So if there is some light, some even small one because of moon or stars or some city, you are not losing it when you are using the red light. So even our eye is reacting on the red light very, very, very well. I will add one more information, especially, and it's very famous to go for some birding in tropical areas in Southeast Asia or South or Middle America and so on. And the forest and leaf forest, they are very bushy and it's very hard to find owls there. Even you can hear the hooting, so calls, and sometimes we are checking it like 2 hours before we can find the owl, which is hearable for us for a pretty long time. Using this red light, even if it is in dark, if it is in twilight, it is very helpful because the eyes are flashing, because there's also something like a tapetum lucidum, what you know from dogs and cats or other mammals. And when you see the eye flashes back, it's very easily then to find the owl, even in very bushy, very, very hard environment for bird searching. So this is very useful and helpful technology. And the last in my pocket, but it's not pocket because it's a little bit bigger, is this stuff. And I can say it's brilliant. However, because the vendor knows it's so brilliant, it's pretty expensive as well. I can tell you it costs, I think, around 4,000 bucks, $4,000. This is the thermoscope. And in a few other slides, I will show you how you can find easily the owl, even owl hidden in very bushy trees for roosting during the day, or if you try to find it, let's say, flying around you in the night. However, be careful if you want to invest in thermoscopes. I did a lot of research and discussed it with a lot of military people. They are using it for a pretty long time. And there are big, big, big differences between all the products. And for these thermoscopes, one rule is valid for 100%. Yes. All, let's say, most expensive equipment is worth for the money. And if you will go down and if you want to save money, you will usually not receive the same quality, and especially for owls and some species which are covered with pretty much quantity of feathers, it will be then harder to find it, especially if there will be some big differences in temperature. So there will be snow during the winter, or it will be all the trees will be let's say warmed by sun during a summer day, then will be very, very hard for you to search for owls, because the chipset and the lens is working with differences in temperatures of all the objects you can see in. And what is very good for me, and it will be something like a marketing for my guiding service, I can make very easily the night safaris, because as you can see at the picture, it contains the Wi-Fi, and I'm searching owls, or I can search lynx and wolves, which are very popular for night safaris in our country. And I got a tablet connected to my Helion, and the people can look the same view I got in my thermoscope, so we can find the animal very easily. And then I will use my red flashlight, and we can see it even in real life, not only in thermal imaging. Here you got a few pictures how it looks like. This is some magnification, so the quality is a little bit worse. This is the tawny owl, Strix aluco. Which you can see, this is especially Strix species. All the Strix species are very, let's say, surrounded by many feathers. So now you can see the eyes are visible and maybe the legs. However, if you will have, let's say, the less good or small quality thermal scope, you will not see it. So this is what is important when you will think about buying such equipment. And on the second picture, you can see the boreal owl, the same story, but with the small owls, it's a different story. It's usually very, very easily visible. And finally, I will tell you something, and I will go a little bit outside of the owl topic. I'm using it very often if I would like to find even other birds, for example, some specialties, some unique birds in environment I'm guiding in. I will give you an example. We are coming with clients to Šumava National Park, where are the three-toed woodpeckers, which are pretty rare in our part of Europe. And it's easily hearable. You can hear it that they are knocking on the trees. However, they are so small, and especially in where there are many, it takes usually like 10 and even more minutes to find it using usual binoculars. But if I use even during the day this thermal scope, it's usually up to 1 minute and I got it because it's visible. This is the big advantage of the thermal imaging over the night vision. Okay, this is very important to know. So thermal scope is my friend number one, and I saw a lot of things, and also it's very, very hard then to explain if you will have your wife or someone who lives with you in the same apartment, why you are so often out for the night. So this is the answer, okay? Because it's opening completely new world for you. So I recommend it if you got some money, if you want to invest it for spotting. For owl spotting is perfect for other animal spotting as well. Just one thing, be careful when you will traveling with it. Definitely there are some countries where the using of such a thermal imaging is limited, and they can put you even to the jail. For example, India is not so friendly for it, and some Asian countries. Oh, don't go to Iran and other countries which are not, let's say, democratic. It's also a problem. I will go, this is not the marketing, but this is really my love. Now you can see my spotting scope on the picture, and it's Kova. Yeah, it's Kova Promina 883. I love it. And there is a sign where the owl is. And now, yeah, during the spring, you can even hear typically nocturnal owl during the day. However, there is very, very hard to find it. And if you have good optics, and if you get some patience, because you have to move a bit, like with 10 centimeters, because you have to find the perfect angle, you will find your owl even during the day, even it's so hidden. And this is, let's say, my hobby, because it's very easy visible on the thermal scope, but then it can take even half an hour or even 1 hour to find it to the scope and make a picture. And I will show you how the picture looks like after. So you can see the owl is very, very hidden, and it's all impossible to find it a different way. However, I will switch to the magical technology for night. And here is where the phone scoping is kicking out or beating all the usual photography. And I can tell it, even I got the history more than 40 years using usual cameras, and I won a few competitions during the years. The producer of mobile phones are, let's say, fulfilling this small equipment with more and more functionality, and especially the night photography is perfect. Here on the picture, and I think, I hope it is visible for you, is the regular picture from my mobile phone using the regular mode during, let's say, beginning of the night. So it's very, I can't tell it, it's a twilight. It's maybe, yeah, it's more dark a little bit. However, I found, because of call and after that, because of my thermal scope, the Ural owl. And this is the result. Oh, sorry, this is Tony owl in Sweden. Sorry, but you will see even the Ural owl. And this is the result, what is bring by night mode from the mobile phone. Yes, there are a few limitations. You have to use usually the top models from the brands. It doesn't matter if this Samsung or Google Pixel or Apple or Huawei or Xiaomi. I think the top models of these vendors are very, very good now in artificial intelligence and processing of the night modes. And they are usually using many exposures, like even for 20 seconds, it was for the 20 second exposure. But the artificial exposition then is putting these images together. And even if the all leaves from the branch where it was perched, like during this time of these 20 seconds, you can have it on the picture. So this is really brilliant part of technology we now got in our pockets, and I really enjoy it. And you can see it's a photography you can easily present on the internet. And if you will be more lucky, and if you will be more used to use it with your scope, you can even print it. I sold even two pictures like this from the night mode from my Samsung. For your information, I'm using Samsung Galaxy Note 20 Ultra. However, you can do it with any other brand with night mode. I think it's going better and better and better. And I'm really, really waiting for new models where they bring more to the night photography. One more example. Now it is the Ural. Now it's typical twilight. However, my colleagues with very, very good equipment from Sony was packing that time because they say, okay, it's impossible to get a nice picture. Yes, you can say it's not the perfect composition, but you see this Ural is pretty nice on the picture, and you can enjoy it, and you can make your fans happy with such a picture on the internet, on Facebook, whatever. So this is the night mode I'm using, and don't worry to use your phones. What is very important to use some remote control for your exposure. So with my Samsung Note, I'm using the S Pen. However, you can use very easily any Bluetooth remote release you can have. Or in iPhone, I think you can use the headphones if you get it on a cable. So yeah, this is the last picture I presented in phone scoping form on Facebook, which is a Boreal Hall, also the night mode 20 second exposition. It's, from me, something like a magic. Like if you get such a picture from mobile phone after 20 seconds of exposition, where there was so low light that it was hard even to walk in the forest, it's crazy. It's some magic. Now back to the quiz. What all species was the most appealing during our webinar? Because we are going to the end. So was it Boreal owl, Aegulus funereus, long-eared owl, Asio otus, short-eared owl, Asio flammeus, northern hawk owl, Cernia ulula? So on pictures, videos, or whatever, what all was the most appealing? Last 10 seconds, and we will see. Oh, yes, we were talking about long-eared owls, but unfortunately, the boreal owl was even more appearing during our webinar. So we got the 9 correct answers. So let me see, but I will see it by the end, who is the best one. The summary for today, this is, let's say, spotting summary for all spotting or all searching or all photography we talked about during this 1 hour and something. So yeah, I'm using Kova equipment, as you know. I really love, and this is message for Kova, the small one, the Genesis Promenade 10x22. This is the perfect scope. If you don't have any experience, check it and you will love it as well. Kova is 883, the spotting scope is very well known. I'm using usually very light tripods and heads. I'm using the Gizzo, but you can pick up another one. Red flashlight or torch, thermal scope, some high-end phone. Unfortunately, the low-end doesn't support a nice mode for night photography. Some perfect phone adapter. This is a very important thing. because otherwise you will have an angle connecting your mobile phone to your scope, and you will not get nice photography, and also you'll have a problem with the focusing. Yes, speaker, then you have to build your environmental knowledge, your searching knowledge, your call recognizing knowledge. Then you have to have a lot of time for sure. And I recommend to have some flask of good alcohol you like, or good drink. I prefer some rum, but you can have a whiskey or whatever. Yes, it's pretty much. You got, and you have to spend a lot of money and a lot of time, and it's, you will count it in thousands, yeah, but it's a passion. If you fall in love with love, it's a passion. But if you are not sure, you are so deeply fault, you got one more chance, and this will be a short marketing window. This is the GG or triple G rule. Get a good guide. It's not only me, definitely, folks. If you will go to South Asia or anywhere, you definitely can find some local people. However, I can tell you, if you will go to Himalaya, if you will go to Malaysia, so Southeast Asia, or if you want to have a very good old spotting in Europe, you will be happy if you will call me and we agree some trip, and I will show you. I think they for now the record of species spotting during one night is 9 species of owls, and for now it's 52 individuals during one night, so usually beginning during the night and end of the night. So it's a huge number, and I think we will go over if you will come in very good conditions, let's say later in the spring, not now, but a little bit later, it's possible to have even more. And if you have more days, we can even do the trip for all European owls. So if you are owl lover and you are located in US or Canada or in Asia, and you want to have such a nice trip in Europe, don't worry, and I will be glad if you will contact me. So here are my contact information. My guiding service has a name, flyfish.cz. You can find more information on my website on www.flyfish.cz. There is also the English part of the website, so you can check all the information, got the contact information, and so on. I run a Facebook profile, but it's more focused on the Czech people because it's some education on and so on, and I'm too lazy to translate it, sorry. And some of these and more pictures, because Instagram is more about pictures, I got on my Instagram profile, which is also the same, the flyfish.cz, and it's English. So if you like, let's say, my all information, and if you would like to get more information, more knowledge, more inspiration, or if you want to join me as a client for some old trip, you are welcome. Follow me. I think you will be happy that I will, let's say, lift your mood, especially in such a bad period of our lives with the virus around. So I got the last video for you. So enjoy it. Folks, now we got the last poll. How did you like this webinar? It's very important to have a feedback. Am I right, Jeff?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I was a little bit longer. I thought that it will be like 1 hour and 10 minutes, and it's a little bit more. So we got like 34 survivors. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. Sorry for them who didn't get the information they want. You can ask me if you will find me in the phone scoping group. And do not forget, I have to go to the to our podium. So for the winners, and I will tell you what the winners will receive. Please, all the winners, check my website, flyfish.cz. The gallery part, you will find them, the old photos, and you can pick one of your one favorite, and tell me what photo it is, and I will send it to you with the highest possible resolution, and you can print it, or you can make it as your desktop wallpaper for your computer. So you will have this small prize from me. So, who was the top three winners? Number three is JC. Congratulations, JC. So now you can search my website. The second was Matthias, and number one, tram-tara, is who? Juanan. Okay, so congratulations, nice points. Okay, to have it a little bit more, I will provide even the fourth and fifth place with the same prize. Because you were many, so thank you for your listening, joining our webinar, and I am providing the word back to Jeff.
All right, Martin, thank you so much. Interestingly enough, oh, you can't see that because I got to put it in front of my
Yes,
face.
you got the same one.
Yeah, that's one of my birding tools that I've used quite effectively.
I just like this red light.
Yeah, I got a red light. So even though we're on opposite ends of the world, we've never met or birded together. We've found some of the same techniques, it seems like. And as another thing that I was, let's see if I could do just yeah, let's see if this will go. So you were talking about the night mode, and I wholeheartedly agree. This is with no flashlight or anything. It was pre-dawn. You can see how wide the pupils are on this Eastern Screech Owl fledgling that was in my backyard.
Perfect.
That I digiscope, same thing, using the night mode, and it looks like it's daytime, but it was so dark that you could just barely see shadows at this point. But
What I can add, Jeff, to the night mode, I'm from time to time during my post-processing, I am, let's say, decreasing the exposure of the night mode. Because Samsung is sometimes providing such a picture that they are looking like a daytime, and I want to have such a look because it's a nighttime picture. So I'm decreasing it pretty much in Lightroom.
Yeah, no, I could see that. It is amazing. It's just like, how does it do that?
And what phone do you use, Jeff?
I got the iPhone 11 Pro Max.
Yes, iPhone 11 is very good.
Any rate,
Unfortunately, you have to have the top line. Yeah, it costs some money, but then you can use it for a long time. It's usually pretty long time supported.
Uh-oh. Can you see the Q&A on the bottom of your screen, Martin?
Yes.
Can you read Martin's? That's a language I'm not familiar with. Is that
There is a problem with the change of the time as in Europe. It's because we hit the difference between United States or America and Europe, and unfortunately, this information was, let's say, not so clear for some people. So who was with the information? It's for 6 p.m. Sorry. However, the explanation is because the United States or America went to summertime, and we are not till now, so we will have to wait. And there was a difference 1 hour, and we agreed. I tried to broadcast it as much as possible, but unfortunately, it was not 100% successful. Sorry.
Apologies on that. That was something that none of us had really thought about between when we agreed to do the webinar and scheduled it. The time switched in between, and we hadn't really thought about that automatic time change at all. It's the first time we'd encountered that. So my apologies. We will have a recorded copy of this that we can view later, that'll live on the COA social media pages. The bird in my background is a mangrove cuckoo, one of my local specialties here in Florida where I live. We see a lot on our boat. But anyway, Martin, thanks so much. We do appreciate it. It looks like that's all the Q&A. If you have any follow-up questions, of course, you can reach out and hit us on our social media pages, send a private message at COA Sporting Optics. You can reach out to Martin, of course, directly. And we thank you for taking the time, and hopefully you all learned some much needed information, and you'll be able to utilize that. I couldn't agree more with what Martin has said about when you get out and start, you know, creeping around at night. It's actually it's great fun and can be very addictive. So
don't forget to say that in counties where the night let's say night free walk is limited now because of COVID, don't do it. Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, good point.
From window. They are very, very active now.
Yeah, indeed. All right. Well, we appreciate you giving us your time, Martin. It was a wonderful presentation.
You're welcome. Thank you
for staying on. And I hope you all have a great rest of your day for those in the U.S. and a pleasant night for those on the other side of the big pond. Thanks again.
Okay. So see you.
Ciao.
You, and congratulations to winners. Don't forget to send me a message.
Perfect.